Hi, hello, how are you? And welcome to another little bit of Grim Tuesday written by Garth Nix. I nearly said Garth Tuesday written by Grim Nix then. Did you notice that? Anyway, let's get cracking with chapter 11, shall we? Arthur leaned desperately to the right as something plummeted past him. Once again, he hardly had time to register what it was beyond a jumbled snapshot of teeth, claws, and tiny, useless wings fluttering madly. What was that?
I don't know, said Susie. Who knows how them gobbits decide what to make when they come together? Bad news for down below.
What?
A Niflin will probably survive the fall. It'll just be really cross. Here, look out!
Arthur flipped his legs forward and threw himself back, tumbling end over end as something that looked like a cross between a boa constrictor and a weasel fell hissing past, its jaws almost close enough to close on Arthur's hand. It fell still closer to Susie, but she whacked it with her copper pipe. Arthur was surprised to hear the clear ringing tone of metal striking metal and to see that none of the pipe had dissolved.
Ouch! Exclaimed Susie. That jarred my hand!
Was that a Niflung? Arthur asked as he regained his flying equilibrium. He kept looking nervously in all directions, though, ready to lean or tumble or do whatever it took to avoid whatever came flying up or falling down next.
Who knows? Said Susie. Most shaped-up Niflins are some sort of flesh, but whatever that was, it was made of metal. Look, it bent my pipe.
How long do we hit the ceiling? Asked Arthur. Susie frowned.
Hard to say, really. We ain't even got to the smoky upper air yet. Maybe an hour or two.
Susie had hardly finished speaking before they broke through the cloud and entered the layer of smog. Arthur had been out of it long enough that he could smell it clearly, many revolting odours combining to create something sharp and acidic in the choking smoke, with overtones of ozone, like from an electric appliance burning out. Fortunately, the spell the lieutenant keeper had taught him was still going strong. Susie, having been in the house long enough to almost be a denizen, was unaffected, though she did wrinkle her nose. The next hour passed uneventfully enough. There were still gobbets of nothing flying around, and once a Niflung fell just close enough to glimpse and cause Arthur a momentary panic. Otherwise, Arthur's wings continued their steady beat and they climbed up through the smoggy darkness. It was impossible to tell where they were, relative to the edges of the pit or the ceiling of the far reaches. After a while, Susie pulled a fob watch out of her apron pocket, opened it and peered at the face.
I reckon that we must be getting close, she said, closing the watch with a practiced one-handed snap.
Try to lie on your back. That'll slow the wings down so we don't crash into the ceiling too hard. Once we hit, use a spell to fully awake your sticky fingers and hold on to the ceiling. Then pull your string and lose the wings and we'll go hand over hand into the treasure tower.
What direction is it going to be in? Asked Arthur as he kicked and threw himself backwards.
Unfortunately, he just did a somersault, confusing him and not slowing his wings for more than a second.
Replied Susie evasively. She had managed to lie on her back by folding her legs up and holding her feet against her face, which was a gymnastic manoeuvre Arthur couldn't hope to match.
He drew his knees up instead and tried to keep them against his chest while he threw himself backwards with rather less vigour.
That sort of worked.
Arthur's wings slowed as they tried to work out the best way to keep ascending.
How will we know where to crawl across the ceiling? Asked Arthur again. I mean, it could be miles away in any direction, couldn't it? Without the light from our wings in the dark and the smog and no landmarks.
We'll work it out, said Susie. And we're just going to be hanging by three little woolen finger puppets to the ceiling with a 1,000 mile or whatever it is drop straight down beneath us.
Don't worry, Arthur, said Susie. Sticky fingers don't come off until you tell them to.
Arthur drew in an angry breath to answer, but before he could, he suddenly saw the ceiling. The breath left him as he frantically raised his arms and legs and braced for the impact. He had expected to hit solid stone, but what he hit was a deep layer of soot. He drove in at least a foot and soot exploded all around him, smothering him in fine particles. There was so much soot his wings couldn't brush it away from him and they flapped harder and harder to keep ascending.
Arthur scrabbled against the ceiling, finally getting his hands and legs braced against the solid stone beneath the soot, as his wings beat furiously in their efforts to push him through the barrier. Susie was nearby, soot cascading down all around her. Her and Arthur's impact had started an avalanche of soot. Hundreds, perhaps thousands of years of accumulated soot had been loosened. Arthur could see it raining down close by and hear it further afield. It made a sound like ice cubes being cracked out of a tray. "Ow!" Susie exclaimed as her balance slipped and her wings drove her face first into the ceiling. She got herself braced again with her knees and elbows firmly against the ceiling while her wings beat madly on her back. "Stick it, spell," called Susie. "Make sure you have your active hand stuck to the ceiling before you undo your wings. And remember, your sticky hand will change every minute." Arthur spat out a mouthful of soot and rubbed his mouth on his shoulder, a very difficult manoeuvre. But he only got more soot on his face. It was everywhere, billowing in clouds and sticking to every part of Arthur's body except for his wings. "This isn't going to work," Arthur called out. He'd been too tired and too pleased to have any chance of escape from the pit to think it through before. But with just one hand sticking to the ceiling, he'd be hanging from it and would have to swing his other hand, get it on the ceiling, and then wait until it stuck. He wouldn't be able to do that for very long before he misjudged the timing or got too exhausted and couldn't even raise his arms. Or worse. "Our arms are going to get pulled out of their sockets," he yelled. "No, they won't," scoffed Susie. But then she frowned and said, "Actually, maybe yours will. Dame Primus didn't think of that." Arthur groaned. It took all his strength to stop his wings from smacking him into the ceiling again and again like a demented moth. Every time they beat, he was pushed into the ceiling and slid around a bit in the soot, bashing his knees and hands and, if he was unlucky, his face or chest. Slid around in the soot. What if we try to crawl with the wings, keeping us pressed against the ceiling?" Arthur said. "The soot makes it kind of slippery, so we can slide our hands and knees along." He demonstrated, timing it so he slid on his hands and knees as the wings readied for the downstrike, bracing himself just as they flapped. He managed to get about 4 feet away from Susie in that slide and was no more bruised than if he'd stayed still. And no more sooty. He was just about as caked in soot as if it was possible to be. Only his teeth, the whites of his eyes and his wings weren't totally black. "It works," he proclaimed. "Very slowly," said Susie dubiously. "I think I'll lose my wings and go hand over hand." "No," said Arthur. He had an image of Susie forgetting to change hands quickly enough or being distracted. There would be that moment where she would hang in the air and then, with a despairing scream, fall into the endless darkness. "No," said Arthur again. "Try moving with the wings like I did." Susie made an indistinct grumbling noise but slid across the ceiling as her hands flexed up, barely bracing herself in time for the next wing beatdown. Excuse me, frog in my throat. "Well, I suppose it does work," she said, "but we'll be black and blue on the knees and elbows by the time we get there." "I seem to be healing up quickly," said Arthur, thinking about the scoucher cut back in his own world. A slight current of fear ran through his mind as he wondered if he was being transformed into a denizen. Then his wings flapped. He almost smacked his nose into the ceiling, and that brought his attention back to the task at hand. "Your bruises won't last long, will they?" "No, but they still hurt while they're around," said Susie. "Come on, let's get going then." "But which direction?" asked Arthur. "Where is the treasure tower?" "It's in the northwest corner of the far realms," said Susie. "Curse these wings. That's all I know." "Which way is north?" "Ah, that really hurt." "Northwest?" asked Arthur. In the darkness, with smog and falling soot all around, there could be no hope of spying any landmarks. "It's on the opposite of southeast." Arthur didn't answer for a moment as he waited for his wings to beat and begin to fold. "You've got no idea, have you?" "I have one odd..." Whatever Susie was about to say was lost as she slipped and her wings pushed her face first into the sooty ceiling. She pushed herself off again immediately, spitting and cursing, resisted the next beat of her wings and then added, "One idea. Ask the Atlas." "Oh yeah, that'll be an easy task, won't it? Opening a book when I need both hands to brace. Arthur's knees slipped and he was violently twisted and thrust against the ceiling, the wind knocked out of him.
"It might not have to open," called out Susie. "Just put one hand on it and ask."
Arthur nodded carefully. His mouth was so full of soot he couldn't speak. He was sure the lieutenant keeper's spell was the only thing preventing him from choking to death. Slowly he drew his elbows in towards his chest so he could still brace against the ceiling and resist his wings, but also touch the atlas in his pocket with his index finger, which didn't have a sticker on it. "Atlas," Arthur started to say, but he slipped again, his elbows splaying out as the right side of his face smashed into the ceiling. He had a black eye for sure now. He had a black eye for sure now, Arthur thought as he struggled to get back into a good position. Not that anyone could tell under the cloak in soot. This time he managed to lock his elbows tighter and he waited till just after the downbeat of his wings. "Atlas, don't open, but show me which way is northwest." Arthur felt the atlas shiver under his hand, lost his concentration and once more went face first into the sooty ceiling. This time, when he prized himself off and braced again, his nose was bleeding and it felt like it might be broken, sending a savage pain lancing up between his eyes.
"Did it work?" called Susie.
Arthur didn't answer. He had his forehead balanced on the ceiling, every muscle straining to resist the next wingbeat, and all of his attention on resisting the pain of a broken nose. Or maybe just a bruised one as the throbbing began to fade. In the next second it stopped bleeding of its own accord, or had so much soot stuffed up it that no blood could get out.
"Did it work?"
called Susie again. Arthur steadied himself and looked back at his pocket.
"No,"
he answered.
"Then, or actually, yeah, I think it has, Susie."
A small compass made of four crossed golden arrows had materialised on his pocket and was slowly spinning as if it were mounted on his shirt. Arthur stared down at it, grunted as his wings flapped, then pointed and slid at the same time.
"Northwest is this way. Come on!"
Susie followed, the two of them developing a rhythm where they slid when their wings folded up and braced when their wings flapped. Though they could only slide 4 or 5 feet at a time, Arthur somehow found it easier to hold himself against the ceiling. More importantly, he finally felt more optimistic. He might be pressed against the ceiling of the far reaches, but he was moving. And he had escaped the pit. "We knew he would, didn't we? Good old Arthur." "They are, I reckon we're about halfway now with that story." Okay. Thank you very much for listening. I did not waffle on too much at the start of the story there. Yes, I saw my complaint on episode 1 of Wintersmith. Just read the story. I like to talk, all right? Not many people listen to me, only 4- and 5-year-olds at work. So I like to talk. When I've got a little captive audience here, of course I'm going to talk to you. Gosh, maybe I'll just have to do all of my talking at the end of the videos from now on, if people don't like it when I talk at the start. I can take criticism. It's okay. I can handle it. I'm a big boy. All right. Okay. I'll see you all tomorrow. Oh, before I... Here comes the talk. Yeah, we're having quite big thunderstorms where I live at the moment. Again, I don't know whether you can see it out here, but just look in that direction. Can you see it very well? I don't know. But, cool. The sky is pitch black. We've had thunder. We've had rumbling. Yesterday was the 9th of May, 2023. We even had hailstones that were so big. Oh my goodness, what is going on? I ask you. Where's my summertime? All right. Okay. 15 minutes left. We're all right. See ya.